Yes, a very good morning to all of you. Right, so had a wonderful time yesterday revising our discussion regarding the audit report. Right, so we completed our discussion regarding the 700, 701, 705, and the 706. Right, we talked about the total contents of the audit report. What are the contents of the audit report? Title, addressee. Then, if it's a clean report, then opinion, basis for opinion. And if it's a modified opinion, then modified opinion and basis for modified opinion. Then you all have all the if any. And a going concern, if any. Emphasis of matter paragraph, if any. Then key audit matters, if any. Right? Other matters, if any. Right? So if these are all visiting paragraphs, then other information, if any. Right? So going concern, it comes as per essay 570. Emphasis of matter, essay 706. Key audit matter, essay 701. Other matter, essay 706. Other information, essay 720. And modification to the opinion, essay 705. Right? And then after that, we talk about the management's responsibility, auditor's responsibility, other reporting responsibilities, and then the signature place and the date. Right? So these were the total contents of the audit report. And what did we say? Three types of modified opinion: qualified opinion, adverse opinion, and the disclaimer of the opinion. Right? Material misstatement, material but not pervasive, and unable to obtain sufficient appropriate audit evidence. There is a limitation on scope, which is again material but not pervasive. Material misstatement, material and pervasive, adverse opinion, and unable to obtain sufficient appropriate audit evidence, material and pervasive would lead to a disclaimer of the opinion. Right, then after that, we said if there is a matter of most significance in the audit of the financial statements of the current period, then key audit matter. Why it is a key audit matter? How the matter has been addressed in the audit. If there is a matter which is fundamental to the user's understanding of the financial statements, right, then it says emphasis of matter. And any matter which is relevant to the user's understanding of the audit, the auditor's responsibility or the auditor's report, then that comes under the other matter. Right, so that was our discussion on the 700 audit report series. Then after that, we discussed the essay 710, comparative information. And regarding the comparative information, we discussed three questions. What is the meaning of comparative information? What are the audit procedures? And then the audit reporting on the comparative information. Right, so comparative information, it could be corresponding figures where only previous year figures are given. Auditor's opinion is only for the current period, or it could be comparative financial statements where the entire set of financial statements of previous year or years is given and the auditor's opinion is for all the periods. Right? And then we discuss the audit procedures and the audit reporting for the comparative information. Then we came to the discussion on essay 600 using the work of another auditor. Right? So principal auditor, head office auditor, company auditor. Can you use the work of another auditor, branch auditor, component auditor? Yes. Can you rely? Yes. But you cannot blindly rely. Why? Because you CTBR continues to be responsible, sole responsibility for the audit opinion expressed. That is why what is required to be done is the evaluation. And what evaluation did I tell you? A and company, V and company, and D and company. Right? So advise the other auditor, visit the other auditor, discuss with the other auditor, coordinate with the other auditor, consider the significant findings of the other auditor, and also consider the professional competence of the other auditor. Right, so that was our discussion on essay 600. Then we came to essay 299, which was regarding the joint audit of the financial statements, where more than one firm of auditor has been appointed to do the audit of the financial statements. So now the joint auditors, you need to prepare a JAP, a joint audit plan. Right, so in that joint audit plan, first by mutual discussion, they need to decide upon the division of audit areas and the common audit areas. Then reporting objective, results of preliminary engagement activities, nature, timing, and extent of resources, and which areas are significant in directing the engagement team efforts. And then we talked about each auditor will assess the RMM. Right, so that was joint audit plan. Then we talked about the areas where the joint auditors are just, that is jointly and severally responsible. Right, one we set for work which is not divided. Then deciding upon the nature, timing, and extent of audit procedures for the common audit areas. Then matter relating to all brought to the attention by anyone. Right, then financial statements, presentation and disclosure of financial statements, and the audit report. Right, so these are the areas where they are JES, that is jointly and severally responsible. And 99.99% of the time, these guys agree upon a common audit report to be issued. But in case of differences of opinion, the joint auditor having a different opinion may report separately, not bound by the views of the majority of the joint auditors. And then they have to make a reference to each other's report in the other matter paragraph. Right? So that was our discussion on SA 290. Nine. Right, so what standards have we completed so far? More or less 200, then 210, 220. Right, then after that, we've also completed with the 700, 701, 705, 706. Right, with 220, we had also done the SQC1, and then we completed with SA 710, SA 600, and the SA 299. Right, and the SA 299. Okay, right. And then after that, we came to the discussion on section 143 of the Companies Act. Right, so 143 subsection 1, duty as to inquiry, 6 points of inquiry. Right, A for advances, B for book entry, C for company, D for deposits, E for expenses, F for fake shares. Right, then 143(3), 10 points of reporting, additional points of reporting. And information proper, branch, books, AS, adverse, directors, maintenance, IFC, others. And under the others also, we had the 7 points over there. Right, so that was 143(3). Then 143(11), it is regarding the CARO 2020. Then if any fraud 1 crore and above, auditor, you need to report it to the central government in the manner as may be prescribed. Then we also discussed 143(8), which was regarding the duty as to the branch audit, okay, who can be appointed as an auditor of the branch. Right, and then regarding our discussion for CARO, what did we discuss regarding CARO? One, the applicability of CARO. Right, what did we say? Possible that for few companies CARO is not applicable because it shall apply to every company, including a foreign company, except private limited company not being a holding or a subsidiary of a public company, paid up share capital reserves and surplus not exceeding 1 crore, total borrowings not exceeding 1 crore, and total revenue as disclosed in Schedule 3, including revenue from discontinuing operations not exceeding the 10 crore. Right, so 1 crore, 1 crore, and the 10 crore. And then 1 person company, small company, Section 8 company, insurance company, banking company. To these 5 companies, CARO never applicable. And once you check that whether CARO is applicable, now you need to report on the 21 clauses of the CARO 2020. Right, so clause 1, property, plant, equipment, intangible assets. Right, clause 2, inventory, working capital. Clause 3, LIGS. Clause 4, LIGS, loans, investments, guarantee, security. Clause 5, public deposits. 6, cost records. 7, statutory dues. 8, undisclosed income. 9, repayment of loans or other borrowings. 10, issue proceeds. Right, so what did we say? Please inform landlord, landlady regarding your deposits, records, dues, undisclosed income, repayments, and issue proceeds. Why? Because of fraud. Right, so fraud is clause 11. Then 12, Nidhi company. 13, related parties. 14, internal audit. 15, non-cash transaction. 16, registration with the RBI. Right, so what do we say? Because a fraud was done by Nidhi, who was a related party, internal auditor found out that she entered into a non-cash transaction without registration with the RBI. And then there is a lot of bad news for the company in 17, right, 18, and the 19. Right, so 17, cash losses. 18, resignation of statutory auditors. 19, material uncertainty regarding the ability to meet the liabilities. And then 2 points of C, right, 2 clauses of C, that is clause 20 and 21, which is your CSR and the CFS. So clause 20 and the 21, CSR and CFS. Through standalone financial statements, clause 1 to 20 of CARO is applicable. And to consolidated financial statements, clause 21 of the CARO is applicable. And though there are 21 clauses, what did we notice? There's so much of these sub clauses for reporting over there, which is making it like the 47 points of reporting under the CARO. Right. So I hope all of you have got a good learning of the subject of audit so far. Right. Good knowledge, good understanding have you developed so far? Right. Did you enjoy the discussion of CARO yesterday? Did you revise? Okay. Right. So anyways, now proceeding further with the next chapter for our discussion, right, which is our chapter number 10, which is regarding the audit of the banks, right? So let us begin with and let us end with the chapter of the audit of the banks. Okay. Right. So we can say that, yeah, in the MCQ part of the paper, 2 to 3 marks is the weightage. And in the theory part of the paper, like 5 marks could be the weightage. Like they can ask one question of 4 marks or 2 questions of 3 marks, or you know, 1 question of 4, 1 of 3, or just 1 question, depends. But more or less, I can say on an average, you know, it is like, you know, 1 question minimum coming in the theory part and minimum 1 question coming in the MCQ part of the paper from the bank audit chapter. Right? So like 5 to 6 mark weightage on an average is what we can put for the bank audit chapter. I say this, next exam you see that, oh, 10 mark bank audit came, or next exam only 2 mark bank audit came, or after that no bank audit question only came in exam. So ICI paper is full of surprises. Whatever we say, it is just based on the average of what has been observed over the years. Right. So yeah, generally, at least we can see 1 question in the MCQ and then another 1 or 2 questions in the theory part of the paper. If ICAI has a change of mind, what they can do, one integrated case study entirely can be for bank audit. Right. So in that case, bank audit in MCQ, the weightage can increase to 6 marks, 8 marks and so. Right. So yeah, but is it an important chapter? Does it almost come in every exam? Yeah, like 99.99% of the time. Every exam, do you see a question from the bank audit chapter? Yes. Okay, and now regarding this bank audit, what did I say? One, in the bank audit, we have to talk about the advances of the bank, the income of the bank, and the expense of the bank. So that's an important part of our discussion. Okay, what are the advances? RBI prudential norm, how to audit. What is the income? How to audit the income of the bank. What are the expenses? How to audit the expense of the bank. But before we come to this advance, income, and expense, there's a lot of other theory discussion over there. Like one theory discussion over there is regarding the types of banks, right? Then what are the laws and regulations applicable to the banking companies, right? Then after that, what is the role, what is the functions of the RBI, right? Then after that, they talk about the appointment of the bank auditor, the remuneration of the bank auditor, and also the reporting by the bank auditor. And then you have the 2 questions over there. One is regarding the bank audit approach. And in this bank audit approach, we have an important discussion over there regarding the ETD. What is ETD? It is regarding the engagement team discussion. And okay, say 70 members in your engagement team who are going to do the bank audit. So should there be a discussion amongst them? And then we also talk about the 18 steps involved in conducting the bank audit. Right, so conducting a bank audit, what are the steps involved in conducting the bank audit? Right, so this is more or less, right, than accounting system in case of bank and others, but this is more or less, I can put it as a snapshot, right, or as a menu card of what we are going to discuss in this particular chapter. Right, so now first let's come to the discussion on the types of the banks. Right, so main function of a bank is what? To accept deposits. Right, so you have some money and you say, I want to open a savings account, current account. So the bank will accept that money as a deposit. Right, so that is one main function of the bank. And another, they accept the deposit. Now, so much money they have. Then what they do? They grant the advances. Right, they give the loan. So I will say, I have taken a loan from the bank. But bank will say that we have given an advance to our customer. right, that we have given the advance to our customer. Right? So these are the, there are many other services provided by the bank, like letter of credit, bank guarantee, CC, overdraft, and all that. But main two functions of the bank is what? Accepting deposits and granting the advances. Right? Accepting the deposits and granting the advances. Right? And the role which the, you know, the banks which perform these functions are called as the commercial bank. Right, the bank which perform these functions of accepting deposits and granting the advances are called as the commercial banks. Right, so first one you have the commercial bank. Right, most widespread banking institution in India that provide a number of products and services to general public and other segments of the economy. And what are the two main functions of this commercial bank? Accepting deposits and granting the advances. Okay, right. Then what does it say? Same like what is done by the commercial bank is also done by the cooperative bank. The only difference is commercial bank is set up like a banking company, whereas a cooperative bank is set up under the Cooperative Societies Act. Then a banking company will be set up under the Companies Act 2013, whereas cooperative bank will be set up under the Cooperative Societies Act 1912 or the Multi-State Cooperative Society Act. Right, so you have commercial bank and the cooperative bank. So what does it say? What do they say? Cooperative bank function like? Cooperative bank function like commercial banks only, but only that they are set up on the basis of the cooperative principle and they are registered under the Cooperative Societies Act. Right, so that is why one type of the banks that we have over there is the commercial bank, and then you have the cooperative bank. So wherever in the name of the bank you see Sahakari, and okay, Janta Sahakari, right? So Sahakari, that means it's cooperative, right? So Gujarat State Cooperative Bank, Chhattisgarh Rajya Sahakari Bank Maryadit, etc. Right, so what is one, two types of bank over here? One classification is the commercial bank and the cooperative bank. Right, then after that, now we have these two new types of bank which have come up, which is the payment bank and the small finance bank. Right, so which new two new types of bank have come over there is the payment bank, and then you also have the small finance bank. Right, so you have the payment bank and the small finance bank, right? So payment bank, obviously, what does it say? They are going to accept only the restricted deposits. Commercial bank, normally they can accept any amount of deposits, but these bank, payment bank, they can accept only the restricted amount of deposits, but they cannot give the loans and the credit card. Right? Customers can open CASA, the current account and the savings account, CASA, current account and savings account, CASA, and also avail the facility of ATM cum debit card. Right? So no credit card, but debit card, yes. Internet banking and the mobile banking. Right? So you have Airtel Payment Bank, India Post Payment Bank, Paytm Payment Bank, etc. Right, so that's a new type of bank which can accept only the restricted deposits. They cannot issue the loans and the credit card, but customers can open the CASA and they can also avail the facility of the ATM cum debit card. Right, so that is the payment bank. And then after that, like say, you know, you're walking on the street or going on your bike and you see a particular fellow who on a, you know, hand cart, he's selling the bananas. And so you see on the entire hand cart over there, he's got only the bananas over there. Or sometimes they only have the grapes or the oranges being sold on that. Or some of them, they keep many different fruits and vegetables in that hand cart over there. Or say there is a cobbler, or say there is some particular, you know, key maker or so. Right. So obviously now if these, you know, the unorganized sectors, right, small and micro business units, like even Modi ji has introduced the Vishwakarma Yojana. So now, if these unorganized sectors, the unserved unorganized sectors, like small marginal farmers, small and micro business units, if they require the finance, then their finance needs are taken care of by the, it's the small finance bank. Right? So small finance bank has been set up by RBI to provide the basic banking and financial facilities to the unserved and the unorganized sectors. Right. So very important over there. Small finance banks are set up mainly to provide the basic banking and financial facilities to the unserved and unorganized. Right. The unserved and the unorganized sectors. Right, the unserved and the unorganized sectors, right? So unserved and the unorganized sectors like the small marginal farmers, small and micro business units, etc. Like, so like you have the Equitas Small Finance Bank, AU Small Finance Bank, then some Jandhan Small Finance Bank, right? So these are the small finance banks. Right? So what you have over there is the payment bank and the small finance bank. And then apart from that, you have the RRB. Right, that is the regional rural bank, right? So again, to provide the banking services in the rural areas, right? That is why you have the regional rural bank, right? So again, mainly for the farmers, right? So regional rural bank are the RRBs, right? Which are set up in the rural areas in different states of the country to cater to the basic banking and financial needs of the rural community. But what does it say? Unserved, unorganized sectors, for that you have the small finance bank. And for the rural communities, you have the RRB, right? So regional rural bank, right? For the rural communities. Right, so generally banking norms say that for every branch which you open in a city, you have to open one branch of the bank in the rural area. Right, so you have the Punjab Gramin Bank, Tripura Gramin Bank, Allahabad UP Gramin Bank, Andhra Pradesh Gramin Vikas Bank, etc. Right, so that is the regional rural bank. And then you have the development bank, which mainly provides the funds for the infrastructure facilities. Right, so development banks have been conceptualized to provide the funds for the infrastructure facilities for the economic growth of the country. Right, so you have the IFCI, then the IDBI, SIDBI, and Industrial Development Bank of India, Small Industries Development Bank of India, etc. Right, so that is the development bank, right? So development bank is for whom? It is mainly for providing the funds for the infrastructure facilities for the economic growth of the country, right? So infrastructure facilities for promoting the economic growth of the country. Right, so what are the types of banks that we have over here? One, commercial bank, then cooperative bank, then two new types of bank, payment bank and the small finance bank, and then one banking sector you have for the rural areas and one for the development. Right, so regional rural bank and the development banks. Right, so again, in the MCQ part of your paper, how there could be a question that a bank which provides fund for the infrastructure facilities, right, infrastructure facilities, right, are mainly known as A, B, C, D, right? And then they say they are known as the commercial bank, known as the cooperative bank, or known as the development bank, or known as the regional rural bank. Next, you know that they are called as the development bank. Right, they are known as the development banks. Okay, right, so that completes one part of our discussion in this chapter, one topic for our discussion in this chapter, that is the types of the bank. Okay, right, then after that, who is the banker to all the banks in the country? It is the RBI. Right, it is the regulating body. And so RBI Act 1934, right? So RBI, a regulating body. Right, so what is RBI responsible for? It is responsible for maintaining the Indian financial system. And in the system, what you have is the policies. What policies? Monetary and credit policies. And also to regulate the activities of the commercial and other bank. Right, so what is the role of the RBI? One, it is the constitutes the development and supervision of the constituents of the Indian financial system. Right? Then for that, they decide upon the monetary and the credit policies. And they also regulate the activities of the commercial and the other banks. Right? So that is the responsibility of the RBI. And then again, there could be a specific question in your exam. Okay, what are the functions of the RBI? Right, so functions of RBI: issuance of currency, regulation of currency issue, right? So 2 points regarding the currency. Right, so issuance of the currency and the regulation of the currency issue, right? So new 550 rupee note, new 500 rupee note, 2000 rupee note set comes, right? So obviously it was issued by the RBI, right? So issuance of currency and the regulation of the currency issue. Then acting as a banker to the central and state government and acting as a banker to the commercial and other type of bank, including the term lending institution. So another role of the RBI is acting as a bank. Right, to the central and state government and also acting as a banker to the commercial and other type of bank. And apart from this, they also have the responsibility to regulate the activities of the commercial and the other banks. Right, so this point was over here. Regulating the activities of commercial other bank, it was there in the responsibility of RBI and also in the functions of the RBI. And obviously, no bank can commence its banking business without obtaining the license from the RBI. And does RBI has the power to inspect any bank? Yes, it has the power to inspect any bank. And do you see a Reliance Bank? Do you see a Tata Bank anywhere? No, because they've not got the banking license over there. Right, so no bank can commence the business of banking without obtaining the license from the RBI. Okay, right, so that's the question regarding the RBI. What is their responsibility and what are the functions of the RBI? Issuance of currency, regulation of currency issue, acting as banker to central state government, acting as banker to the commercial and other type of bank, and also regulating the activities of the commercial and other bank. Right, and then after that, independent audit of the financial statements of a bank is required. Obviously, banking operations can be conducted only at the branches of the bank. Right, if the bank is having some other offices like controlling authorities or administrative offices that lay down policy systems, internal control procedures, it says those other branches, the banking, those other offices, the banking operations cannot be conducted. Right? These controlling administrative offices also stipulate the delegation of power and fixed responsibility and accountability. And these are generally involved in effective supervision, monitoring, control over the business, including seeking faithful compliance of banks' laid down policy procedures and deals with deviation. Right? So they made an MCQ for this one. Okay, whether bank can conduct its banking operations from its controlling or administrative offices? No. It can only conduct its banking operations only from its branches, not from its other offices, which are the controlling authorities or the administrative offices. Right? So, controlling office, administrative office, from there can a bank do the banking operation? No. The bank can do the banking operation only from its branches. Right? So, that's an important point from the viewpoint of the MCQ. Right, then what are the laws and regulations applicable in case of a banking company? So obviously banking company. So one, Reserve Bank of India, Banking Regulation Act. Then obviously if it's a company, then what is going to be applicable is the Companies Act 2013. Right, then after that, nowadays banks also IT. Right, so you have Information Technology Act, PMLA Act. Right, so Prevention of Money Laundering Act. Right, then the Securitization and Reconstruction of Financial Assets and Enforcement of Security Interest Act, popularly known as the SARFAESI. Right, so SARFAESI Act over there. Right, and then apart from that, what does it say? State Bank of India Act 1955, State Bank of India Subsidiary Bank Act 1959. Right, the next one is a very nice name to remember: Banking Company Acquisition and Transfer of Undertaking Act 1970-1980. So only the years are different, but the same act. Right. And apart from that, what are the last three which you have over there? RRB. Right. Then the Credit Information Company Regulation Act, Payment and Settlement Systems Act 2007. Right. So what are the laws and regulations which are applicable to the banking company? Right. What are the laws and regulation? Right. Then what are the special features of a bank? Right, so Reliance Industries, it will have their bank account. But State Bank of India, oh my God, so many people's bank account would be over there. And a 24 crore bank accounts or so. Right, so what does it say? What are the peculiarities involved in case of bank? One, the huge volume and complexity of transaction. Right, so huge volume of the transaction. And then all that transaction is not taking place at one place because banks have a geographical spread of the bank's network. Like yesterday we saw State Bank of India, 22,000 branches. Right, so geographical spread of the network. Then they are not doing just one or two activities. They have a large range of products and services. And obviously, all of this is done with the help of the technology. Right? So there is extensive use of the technology. We talk about the core system of the banking, right? The centralized online real-time electronic system of the banking to be is system being used in case of the bank, right? The core system of banking. And in spite of all this, they can't decide anything on their own. They have the strict vigilance by the banking regulator, that is the RBI. Right? So these are the special features of a bank. Right, huge volume of transaction, geographically dispersed, large range of products and services, extensive use of technology, and strict vigilance by the banking regulator. Right, so you see huge volume, wide geographical spread, large range of product, extensive use of technology, and the strict vigilance. Right, so these are the peculiarities involved in the bank. Okay, right, then types of bank audit report, I'll come to that when we talk about the reporting ahead. Right, then they talk about the understanding of the accounting system in case of bank. Right, so what did I say? Nowadays bank, you have the core, right, the centralized online real-time electronic system being used in the case of bank. They say CBS, and the core banking solution. है ना, दे टॉक अबाउट दी CBS. What does CBS stand for? The core banking solution in case of the bank. Right? So for from the time the customers had to physically visit and deal with the bank, there is a sea change in banking as use of technology and its continuous evolution. Right? Internet and mobile connectivity, right? So you have your banking app on your phone also, plus you can have do the internet login also, right? Wide range of innovative products and services to their consumers, right? To their customers. Right? Obviously, the volume of transactions is very hi, and all the recording of the transaction is done by the system. I go to an ATM to withdraw money. The debit entry automatically it is generated by the computer system, right? And obviously, again, in case of computerized environment, the RBI has issued the guidelines, right? The norms, parameters which are to be followed. An auditor, what he should do? He should not go by the assumption that system generated information is correct. He says, "Arey, ye toh sara report has been generated by system, so it will be correct." Not necessary. He should not go by the assumption. So again, they made a question on this one. You know, in a, what you say, computerized system, because the reports are generated by the system, the CA should go with the assumption that system generated information is correct? No. And the auditor should not go by the assumption that system generated information is correct and can be relied upon without evidence that demonstrates that the system driven information is based on the parameter. He has to use the professional skepticism and the prudence wherever he feels that something manually needs to be performed to check the authenticity and the consistency of the information obtained from the system. And so wherever you think that, oh, this question may not come, right? That is probably the question which is going to come in the exam. Right? So whichever question you study, one, you understand it from the short note, and they can ask you the full discussion, okay, understanding of the accounting system in case of bank, or they can ask you some particular in the computerized environment of the bank, or they can make an MCQ from the same. Right? So should you go by the assumption that system generated information is correct? No, not go by the assumption that system generated information is correct. Right? And then we talk about the bank audit approach. Right? So what has to be your approach? First, draw the audit plan. Right? Then based on the audit plan, it says now you need to study the control environment at the bank. You know, today we are also going to do our discussion. Pay attention, everyone, on the chapter number 3, which is regarding the risk assessment and the internal control. Right? And then we are also going to discuss a little bit of the SA-315, right? Identifying and assessing the risks of material misstatement. Yes, risk of material misstatement through understanding the entity and its environment. Right? As a part of understanding the entity and its environment, you have to understand the internal control system. As a part of understanding the internal controls, you have to understand the 5 components of the internal control system. You know, 5 parts of the internal control system. And what are the 5 parts of the internal control system? It is like the ice cream. You know, but here our ice cream spelling is little corrupted. It says CRISM. You know, so ice cream, right? So it's like the CRISM. Right, so what does this CRISM over there stand for? For the components of the internal control system, you have the control environment. Right, you have the control environment. Then after that, the risk assessment. Right, so control environment, risk assessment. Then information system and communication. Right, information system and the communication, then control activities, and then after that the monitoring. Right, then after that the monitoring. Right, so control environment, okay, how much importance are they giving to controls in the organization? Are they like chalta hai, theek hai, itna load nahi, that type, or are they like committed to competence and a participation of TCWG? So that's the control environment. Then, how do you design a control system? First, you identify where all fraud error can take place. And then wherever you think, oh, if there is no control over here, fraud can happen, error can happen. Accordingly, you design the control. Right? That why at the shopper stop when you are leaving from the store, there is a security guard standing over there to check your bill. Because they have done a risk assessment. Oh, probably employee without doing the billing also, they may take away the product. Right, so that is what risk assessment. Right, so unless and until you assess the risk, you can't design the control. Once risk assessment is done, accordingly you develop the information system, and okay, purchase order, quotation, a quotation, purchase order, invoice. You develop your information system. Accordingly, the control activities are defined, and then monitoring. And okay, whether these controls are they operating effectively or whether they are not operating effectively. Right? So that is monitoring is like the internal audit. Okay, time and again you have to check the effectiveness of your internal control system. Right? So keep in mind, okay, whenever we talk about internal control, we talk about the five components of the internal control system, five tukdas, and five parts of the internal control system. And what are these five parts of the internal control system? CRISM. And a control environment, risk assessment, information system and communication, control activities, and the monitoring. Okay, now here also what they are saying, okay, auditor, when you are doing the audit of the bank, your bank audit approach, you have to check the control environment at the bank. Right? Okay, whether the bank is having the appropriate control to mitigate, to reduce, to cover, to manage the risks, including segregation of duties, division of work, accurate measurement and reporting of position, verification and approval of transaction, reconciliation of the position and result, setting up of the limit, reporting and approval of the exception, physical security and the contingency planning. Right? So all these are the controls which should be there at the bank. Okay, there should be proper division of work. And no single person should handle a transaction from the beginning to the end. Then there should be accurate measurement and reporting of position. Then verification and approval of transaction. Reconciliation of position and result. Then setting up of the limits. Reporting and approval of exception. Physical security and the contingency planning. Right? And then what are the common questions which you will ask in regard to the control activity? Who performs the control and does the person have the knowledge and authority? Then what evidence is available to show that the control is performed? Right? Then when and with what frequency the control is performed and is the frequency enough to PDC and RMM? And a risk of material misstatement. Then where is the evidence of the control retained? For how long is the evidence retained? Like what we said, audit trail. And it should be preserved at least for 8 years. Is the evidence accessible, available for the audit? Why is the control being performed? So what risk are you trying to mitigate? What types of errors are prevented or detected through the performance of the control? And then how the control is performed, what are the activities, can these activities be bypassed, if they are bypassed, can they be detected, what are the deviations, exception, and what is the time frame for resolving the deviations and the exception, right, what is the time frame, right, so that is where they have the questions regarding the controls, and the control activities in the organization, what does it say, what are the common questions and steps which have to be kept in mind. Right, while undertaking or performing the control activities, okay, who, what, when, where, right, so who, what, when, where, and why, and then after that the how, right, so 5 W's and 1 how, right, so who, what, when, where, why, and then the how, right, how these controls are being performed, right, so that's control environment at the bank, right, control environment at the bank. Okay, and then they talk about the ETD. What is ETD? Engagement team discussion. Right, so say you are appointed as the auditor of State Bank of India, example, or maybe say Punjab National Bank, or maybe say ABN AMRO Bank, any bank. Right, and now what does it say? You have these 70 members in your engagement team. Right, so should there be discussion amongst the members of the engagement team? Yes, at which stage of the audit? At the planning stage of the audit, MCQ. And okay, at which stage of the audit there should be discussion amongst the members of engagement team? Obviously at the start of the audit. So start of the audit, what you do the planning, right? So at the planning stage of the audit, then it says, what are you going to discuss? Right? So what are the matters which are going to be discussed amongst, like say, the 70 members of engagement team? One, errors that may be more likely to occur. है ना कि कौन से एरियाज में बैंक में गड़बड़ हो सकता है ना फ्यूचर राइट एंड देन एरर्स व्हिच मे हैव बीन आइडेंटिफाइड इन द प्रायर ईयर राइट सो व्हाट एरर्स वी मे फाइंड आउट एंड व्हाट एरर्स वी हैव ऑलरेडी फाउंड आउट इन द पास्ट Right? So one discussion is regarding the error. Then the methods by which the fraud may be perpetrated by bank personnel. Right? So how these bank employees can do the fraud? Right? You know, some person has taken a bank locker and then the revenue is not being recorded or the rent is not charged. Right? So how the fraud can be done? Right? Then what are the responses to these risks? Right? So engagement risk, pervasive, that is overall risk, and the specific risk. Then obviously, if there is a fraud risk, right, then what does it say? You need to maintain the professional skepticism, and being skeptical is nothing but need to remain alert. Right. So these are the 6 points, 2, 2, and 2, right, which you have regarding the ETD. And engagement team discussion, areas in which errors may occur, then errors which have been identified in the prior years, then methods by which the fraud may be perpetrated, then the responses to engagement risk, pervasive risk, and the specific risk, then need to maintain the professional skepticism, need to remain alert for information or other condition. Right, then why this ETD? Okay, what are the advantages of the engagement team discussion? Right, so what is the advantage? It will help you identify those areas where there is a higher chance of fraud and error. And the susceptibility of banks' financial statements to material misstatement due to fraud. And so where there is more chance of fraud error happening in the financial statements, by doing this discussion amongst engagement team members, you can identify those susceptible areas. And you can identify those susceptible areas. Now you know, okay, oh, this bank audit, these are the very dangerous areas for the audit. So accordingly, you can decide to whom the work is to be delegated. And the dangerous areas, you give it to the most skilled people in your firm. Right? And sometimes you say, oh, there is nobody in our firm who can do this work. So in that case, you may decide to involve the specialists. So only when you had a discussion, then you can come to know okay, where all there is a risk. Then whether we have to whom the work is to be delegated. And if you think you don't have the people to do the work, then involve the specialist to address the issues related to the. Right. So yes, again, a question has come few times in your exams regarding engagement team discussion. Right. So point one, it is to be done at the planning stage of the audit. Then what are the matters to be discussed? And then what are the advantages of such a discussion? Okay, why ETD? And so susceptibility, then also the delegation of the work and whether there is a need to involve the experts. Right, whether there is a need to involve the specialists. Okay, right, so that is a bank audit approach. Okay, right, then after the bank audit approach, we talk about the form and content. Right, so banking companies, do they need to follow Schedule 3? No, banking companies, the format for the preparation of financial statements have been given under the Banking Regulation Act, right? The balance sheet, profit and loss account, right? For the nationalized bank, State Bank of India, and also for the RRBs, right? So again, could this be an MCQ? Yes. And this is the programming which I want of your brain to be done whenever you study any chapter. Okay, iska kya question ban sakta hai? You know, what theory question can come, what wholesale question can come, what retail question can come, and what micro MCQ level question can come. And okay, Banking Regulation Act, it has given the format for the preparation of financial statements and it is applicable to nationalized banks, State Bank of India and the RRP. Right, so it talks about the balance sheet and the profit and loss. Do banking companies also need to follow the accounting standards? Yes, to the extent possible. Insofar as they apply to banking companies, they need to apply the follow the accounting standards also. Right, then who appoints the auditor in case of bank? MCQ. You know, who appoints the auditor? Right, so again, as a general rule, the auditor of a bank is to be appointed by the shareholders in the general meeting. You know, just like any other company, even in case of a banking company, the auditor is to be appointed by the shareholders in the general meeting. However, in case of a nationalized bank, like say Punjab National Bank, in case of a nationalized bank, the auditor is appointed by the concerned bank acting through its board of directors. Right, so ICICI Bank auditor will be appointed by shareholders in general meeting, but nationalized bank auditor will be appointed by the concerned bank acting through its board of directors. That means board of directors. And whether appointed by shareholders or whether appointed by the board of directors, the approval of RBI is required before the appointment is made. Right, the approval of the RBI is required before the appointment is made, right? So who appoints the auditor? It says the auditor. Pay attention, everyone. Sit straight. Banking company is appointed by the shareholders in the AGM. However, in case of a nationalized bank, the auditor is appointed by the concerned bank acting through its board of directors, right? In either case, the approval of the RBI is required before the appointment is made. Right, then who decides the remuneration in case of the banking company auditor? It says in the same manner as given under section 142. And okay, company in general meeting or in the manner determined therein. Right, so company in general meeting or in the manner determined therein. And remuneration of the auditors of Nationalized Bank and State Bank of India. Right, so generally decided as per section 142, but Nationalized Bank and State Bank of India, there the remuneration is fixed by the Reserve Bank of India in consultation with the central government. Right, so what does it say? Generally, yes, so this is regarding the appointment. Then we talk about the remuneration, right? So remuneration of the auditor is to be decided as per section 142. And okay, company in general meeting or in the manner determined therein. However, in case of Nationalized Bank and in case of State Bank of India, right, what does it say? The remuneration will be determined by the fixed by the Reserve Bank of India in consultation with the central government. Right, by the State Bank of India, Nationalized Bank, the remuneration will be fixed by the Reserve Bank of India in consultation with the central government. Right, so again, please mark it as an MCQ. Right, then the auditor's report, that auditor of a banking company is, again, it talks about in case of Nationalized Bank. Right, the auditor, you have to make a report to the central government. So again, MCQ. Okay, auditors, do they need to report to shareholders in case of Nationalized Bank? No, they need to report to the central government. What? That whether the financial statements of the bank give a true and fair view. Then whether they have got all the information, explanation, and whether it is found to be satisfactory. This is new. There we only say, have you obtained information explanation in normal company. Banking company, we say, have you obtained information explanation? And also whether that information explanation which we've obtained, is it satisfactory? Right? Is it satisfactory? Then returns received for the branches, whether they have been found adequate. Then whether or not the transactions of the bank, are they within the powers of the bank? And any other matter which the auditor considers should be brought to the notice of the central government. Right? So these are the contents of the audit report. Okay, auditor of a nationalized bank, you will report to the central government. What will you report? Financial statements, do they give a true and fair view? Information explanation satisfactory. Returns, are they adequate? Transactions of the bank, are they within the powers of the bank? And any other matter which the auditor considers should be brought to the notice of the central government. Okay, right, then in the audit report, auditor, do you need to mention the number of the unaudited branches? Yes, not only give information relating to the number of unaudited branches, but also give the quantification of the advance deposit interest income of such unaudited branches. Right, so if I like come over here to State Bank of India audit report. Right, so over here, Right? Do they mention over here clearly the number of branches which have been audited by the branch auditor? Yes, these are 5,000 branches. And then what do they also say? There are the unaudited branches. Huh? Yes, which there are the unaudited branches. The branches audited by us and those which have been audited by the other auditors have been selected by the bank in accordance with the guidelines issued by the RBI. Also incorporated in the balance sheet profit and loss account are the returns of 19,000 branches. Right? So what do they have? 19,000 branches which have not been subjected to audit. Right? So what does it say? 19,000 Indian branches, including accounting units, which have not been subjected to audit. And these unaudited branches account for 25% of advances, 39% of deposits, 21% of the income, and 37% of the interest expense. This is exactly the sentence written over here. Okay, for the branches which have not been audited, you can't only give the information that 19,000 branches are not being audited, but you also need to give the quantification. Right, quantification of the advances, deposit, interest, income. And also need to give the quantification of the advance deposits, interest income and interest expense of such unaudited branches is also required to be disclosed in the audit report. And is CARO applicable to banking company? No, CARO not applicable. So if CARO is not applicable to banking company, then what is applicable to banking company? LFAR. And the long form of the audit report. Who has given the contents of the LFAR? The RBI. Which auditors of which bank need to report on LFAR? Public sector bank, private sector bank, foreign bank, as well as their branches. And by what date this LFAR report is to be submitted? By 30th June every year. Right? So what does it say? Who has given the format of the contents of the LFAR? The RBI. Which auditors of which banking companies need to report on LFAR? Public sector bank, private sector bank, foreign bank, as well as their branches. And what is the due date for reporting on LFAR? By 30th June every year. Right? And in case of a bank, if any fraud is found out, what does it say? Auditor, will you report it to central government? 143.12, duty to report fraud to CG? Yes. But in addition to that, it says, auditor, you will also report the matter to the RBI, in addition to the chairman, managing director, chief executive of the concerned bank. Right? So you report it to central government, that is as per 143.12. But do you also need to report it to the bank management? Yes. Do you also need to report it to the RBI? Yes. You also need to report it to the RBI. Right? And then over here, we also talk about the contents of the bank audit report. Right? So one bank auditor, you have to give the main report, which is your true and fair report. Then in addition to the true and fair report, what does it say? Auditor, in addition to your main audit report, you also have to give the report on IFC and internal financial control. Then in addition to IFC, LFAR, because CARO is not applicable, so LFAR, which has been specified by the RBI. Then in addition to LFAR, what does it say? Reporting on compliance with SLR, statutory liquidity ratio. Then report on the treasury operations of the bank. Then whether the bank has complied with the RBI guidelines. Then whether there is any serious irregularity which has been noticed in the working of the bank. Even that report is to be issued. Then report on the recommendations of the Ghosh Committee and the Jilani Committee, whether those recommendations have been implemented. And any adverse credit deposit ratio in the rural areas, right? So types of bank audit report to be issued generally. So what is main bread and butter? True and fair. In addition to that, IFC, LFAR, then SLR, treasury, then RBI guidelines, serious irregularity, and the Ghosh Jilani committee recommendation, and the adverse credit deposit ratio in the rural areas. Right, so these are the types of the bank audit report to be issued. Right, so types of the bank audit reports to be issued. Okay. Right, and then drawing an audit plan, ETD, engagement team discussion, financial statements, appointment, remuneration, reporting by the bank auditor. Right, and then we talk about the steps involved in conducting the bank audit. Right, so what are the steps involved in conducting the bank audit? Initial consideration. Like, you know, even when a new client approaches us, first what we do? Acceptance continuance of client relationship. You remember LEAHEM. SKC 1 SA 220. So similarly, if you are to be appointed as the auditor of any bank, will you say, okay, coming for bank audit? No. First, declaration of indebtedness. Then maker checker has to be different. Are you doing any other internal assignments in bank? देन प्लानिंग, देन एनओसी कम्युनिकेशन विद प्रीवियस ऑडिटर, एंगेजमेंट लेटर, इनिशियल ऑडिट, असेसमेंट ऑफ एंगेजमेंट रिस्क, एस्टैब्लिश द एंगेजमेंट टीम एंड देन अंडरस्टैंड द बैंक एंड इट्स एनवायरमेंट, राइट? सो दीज आर द इनिशियल कंसिडरेशन, लाइक स्टार्टिंग पॉइंट, राइट, वेन यू आर प्रपोज टू बी अपॉइंटेड एज एन ऑडिटर ऑफ द बैंक. Now that you've decided green signal, we are going to do the bank audit. Now you have to understand the bank and its environment. Understanding of the bank and its environment, you have to understand the internal control. Obviously, in the bank and its environment, when you understand, you are identifying, assessing the RMM. You also understand the bank's accounting process. Right? Today, as I told you, I'll be discussing with you the SA315. Right, what is SA315? Identifying and assessing the risk of material misstatement through understanding the entity and its environment. So here, what do they say? You understand the entity and its environment, including internal control, and then you identify, assess the RMM, the risk of material misstatement. How? Through understanding the entity and its environment. Right? Then after the understanding of the entity, identifying, assessing the RMM, you have to understand the risk management process. You know, because running a bank, is there not some risk involved in the bank also? Yes, so now bank, it says you need to have a risk management committee. And this risk management committee will lay down a risk management process. And this risk management process, please pay attention everyone, is similar to the five components of internal control which I told you, PRISM. And a similar risk management system is similar to internal control system. Because what do we say? Control environment. So that is oversight and involvement of TCWG. Then risk assessment. So risk assessment is your identification, measurement, monitoring of risk. Then you have the information system. So that is reliable information system, right? Then you have the control activities, right? So that's the control activities. And last but not the least, you have the monitoring, right? So you also have the monitoring activities. Right? So understanding the risk management process of the bank is similar to the five components of the internal control system, that is CRISM. It is similar to the five components of the internal control system. Right? So it says you've understood the bank and its environment, understood the risk management process. Now all understanding done, done. So now there has to be ETD. And an engagement team discussion is at the planning stage of the audit. After engagement team discussion is done, now you establish your audit strategy, develop your audit plan, and then prepare the audit planning memorandum. Right? So audit strategy, audit planning memorandum, which is coming from SA 300, planning and audit of the financial statements. Then it says auditor, you also need to determine the materiality, SA 320. Also need to consider the going concern, SA 570. Also assess the risk of fraud, including the money laundering, right? So the money laundering is, laundering word is missed over there, right? So assess the risk of fraud, including the money laundering. So SA 240. And auditor's responsibilities relating to fraud. Right? So whether RPIS guidelines for PMLA, prevention of money laundering, and KYC norms, have they been complied with? Then after that, it says you, or yes, so laundering word has come over here. Right? So that's what they, is happening as the, happened as a drafting error over there. Right? Then assess the specific risk, then risk associated with outsourcing of activities. Then after you assess the risk, you need to respond to the risk. Then say, imagine each and every asset of the bank becomes a non-performing asset. So will the bank be able to survive even in such worst possible economic situation? That is stress testing. Right? Imagining the worst possible economic news, will the bank be able to survive, is called as the stress testing of the bank. That does the bank have the enough capital, right, to survive even the worst possible economic situation. And then the Basel III. What is Basel III? It's an international banking regulation. Okay, not only RBI, but across the world, whichever bank, they have to maintain the capital, regulatory capital, as decided under the Basel III framework. Why Basel? Because that's the name of the place where this particular framework has been decided. Right? So why it is called as Basel? Because that is the name of the place where this particular framework has been decided. Right? So Basel Committee on Banking Supervision and the Financial Stability Board, they talk about the regulatory capital to be maintained by the bank. And statutory auditor, when you are doing the audit of the bank, will you take into consideration the adverse comments in previous year audit report? Yes. Latest internal inspection report? Yes. RBI inspection report? Yes. Concurrent internal auditor report? Yes. So statutory auditor, will you consider the reports of all these people? Previous year report, internal report, RBI report, concurrent internal auditor report, then report on verification of security, any other internal report, and manager charge handing over his report when the incumbent, when the staff has been changed. Right? So all these reports will also be considered by the statutory auditor. Right. So that is more or less the discussion from our standards on auditing. Okay, yes, what is that? Conducting the bank audit. What are the steps involved in conducting the bank audit? Right. So right from the initial considerations by the statutory auditor up to using and relying upon or reviewing the reports of the other auditors, looking into the adverse comments in the reports of the other auditors. Right, so auditor should take into account the adverse comments, if any, on the advances appearing in the following. Right, so all these other reports are to be considered. Okay, the above report should be reviewed in detail. Right, so that completes one part of our discussion in this chapter. Right, so we have prepared a summary at the beginning today. And then we say laws and regulations, RBI, appointment, remuneration, reporting, bank audit approach, and the steps involved in conducting the bank audit. Right. So now we talk about the advances, the income, and the expense of the bank. Right. So advances is the heartbeat of this chapter. And what is the most important part of our discussion in the chapter of the bank audit is the discussion regarding the advances. Okay, right. So now over here, when I talk about the advances, right, then and if I quickly come to the State Bank of India, and this is their audit report, right, the annexure regarding the IFC, and then you see the advances given on the note number 9, right, schedule 9, right, so scheduled 434 other liability. Balances with bank, investment, right? And then over here you see the advances of the State Bank of India, right? So what does it talk about the advances? Bills purchased and discounted, cash credit, overdraft, loans repayable on demand, term loan, right? So BCT, what is BCT? Bills purchased, discounted, cash credit, OD, ROD, and the term loans, right? So that is one breakup, 326,7902. And one breakup, BCT. Then another breakup of the 326 is secured, covered by bank government guarantee, and unsecured. Again, same figure. And then third breakup, advances in India, priority sector, public sector, bank, others. Outside India, due from bank, due from others. Bills purchased, discounted, syndicated. That is more than one bank coming together and giving loan, also called as the consortium loan. And then again the breakup. Right, so same figure, you know, advances kitna hai bank ka? 326,3267902,1273. But three breakups of that have been given. One breakup is BCT, you know, bills purchased and discounted, then cash credit overdraft and the loans repayable on demand and term loan. Second breakup is SCU, secured by tangible assets, covered by bank government guarantee and unsecured. And third breakup is advances in India and the advances outside India. Right, so what does it say? What do the advances of the bank comprise of? BCT, STU. What is the legal requirement for the disclosure? BCT. And now what is that? Bills purchased, discounted, cash credit, OD, ROD, term loan. Then you have the SCU. And is secured by tangible assets, covered by bank government guarantee and the unsecured. And then you have the advances in India and the advances outside India. Right, so priority, public sector, bank and the others, and due from bank, due from others, bills purchased, discounted, syndicated loans and the others. right? So BCT, STU. Okay, and all these advances of the bank, what does it say? It could be a funded advance or it could be a non-funded advance. Funded, which involves the actual transfer of the fund, right? So what you have your BCT over there, right? So term loan, cash credit, overdraft, demand loans, bills discounted, this bills discounted purchase, participation on risk sharing basis, interest bearing staff loan. This is all which involves the actual transfer of the fund. And then where bank guarantees have been given, letters of credit have been issued, but there is no actual transfer of the fund, then that is called as the non-funded advance. Right? So funded. So I take a term loan from the bank. Bank gives me a check of 5 crore. So it involves the actual transfer of fund. So that is funded. But bank gives the bank guarantee on my behalf of 100 crore. It does not right now involve any actual transfer of the fund. So that is the non-funded facility. Right, so funded and non-funded. And then what is the disclosure requirement? BCT, SCU. Right, and then classification of advances. Right, so one classification of advance could be sector-wise. You know, banks could have been lended to the priority sector or other than priority sector. Right, so priority sector, agriculture, MSME, education, housing, etc. You know, RBI has issued the guidelines regarding targets have been given to the bank that how much of their advances are to be given to priority sector. Right? Then second classification of advances could be based on the security. Right? And what does it say? One would be the main security, the principal security against which the credit has been extended by the bank. Right? The primary security. So if I want a loan of 5 crore, I give my building as a security to the bank. So that is the primary principal security, the main security against which the credit has been extended by the grant. But a relative of mine also signs a guarantee form. So that's a collateral security. That is an additional security. And not the main security. And a primary security is the main security against which the credit has been extended. But collateral is the additional security. And security could be tangible, intangible, movable or immovable. And what are the common types of security? Like personal security of the guarantor. Or it could be security of the goods, inventory, that is your debtors. Right? Or your inventory, then gold ornaments, immovable property, plantation, right? Banker's general lien, life insurance policy, stock exchange securities and the other instruments. Right? So these are the common types of securities. And then after that, another important question for the MCQ is the mode of creation of the security of the bank. Right, so can I take a loan against my inventory? Yes. Can I take a loan against my building? Yes. Can I take a loan against my life insurance policy? Yes. Can I take a loan against my debtor? Yes. So how these securities are created in the name of the bank? Right, so you have the mortgage, right? You have the mortgage, pledge, hypothecation, right? Mortgage, pledge, hypothecation, assignment, right? The assignment, the set off, and the lien. And the 6 modes of creation of the security, right? So mortgage, pledge, hypothecation, assignment, set off, and the lien. And a mortgage, pledge, hypothecation, assignment, set off, and the lien, right? By which the security can be registered and then, you know, could be put in, given in the name of bank. And a mortgage, pledge, hypothecation, assignment, set off, and the lien. Okay, mortgage, which is generally for your properties in a land, building or so. And it says it could be registered mortgage or it could be the equitable mortgage. Registered mortgage, where that property is registered in the name of bank. Right, so that is registered mortgage. And equitable mortgage, it takes place just by giving the transfer of the delivery documents and the ownership document. Okay, whatever is the ownership, owner, what do you say, original title deed of the building, I hand it over to the bank. Right, so is it registered in the name of bank? No, it is just the title and merely the delivery of the documents is done to the bank. That is equitable mortgage. Whereas registered mortgage, it is actually registered in the name of the bank. ओके, सो मॉर्गेज कैन बी ऑफ टू टाइप्स, है ना, रजिस्टर्ड मॉर्गेज एंड द इक्विटेबल मॉर्गेज, राइट? सो रजिस्टर्ड मॉर्गेज कैन बी अफेक्टेड बाय अ रजिस्टर्ड इंस्ट्रूमेंट कॉल्ड द मॉर्गेज डीड साइंड बाय द मॉर्गेजर. इट रजिस्टर्स द प्रॉपर्टी टू मॉर्गेजी एज अ सिक्योरिटी. Right, so it gets registered in the name of the bank. An equitable mortgage takes place only by the mere delivery of the title deeds or the other documents of title with an intent to create the security thereof. Right, that is just these original title deeds of the building, I give it to the bank. That is called as the equitable mortgage. Right, then after that, say I want to take a loan from the bank against, say, the secure, for, against, say, by giving my gold as a security. Right, so now in this case, what happens? The ownership of the asset, right? What does it say? Bailment or delivery of the goods, right? So what does it say? Does the ownership of the asset go to the bank? No. But is the possession of the security with the bank? Yes. Right, so all this, you know, the old ladies, you know, they put all their gold in a piece of cloth, and then that piece of cloth, you know, they take it to the bank and against that take a loan. Right, so what is that? That is pledge. It involves bailment or delivery of goods by the borrower to the lending bank with the intent of creating a charge thereof as a security. Obviously, legal ownership of the goods remain with the pledger, while the lending bank gets the defined interest in the goods. Right? So, example for pledge could be like, say, the gold. Okay, then say I'm having some inventory. You know, like Tata Motors and all these companies, they would be having their inventory. Now, obviously, my inventory, if I give it to the bank as a security, they keep it in their possession, I cannot run my business. Right? So, in case of hypothecation, neither the ownership nor the possession is transferred to the bank. The borrower continues to hold the physical possession of the goods as the agent trustee of the bank. But only a hypothecation agreement is entered into for the movable securities belonging to the borrower. Right? So generally for your inventories, you go for the hypothecation. Right? You create a, enter into a hypothecation agreement. And periodically you have to submit the statements to the bank, because obviously inventory is not going to remain the same. Right? It will keep on changing. So that is why the periodic statements are required to be submitted to the bank. Okay, right. Then at a future date, right, what does it say? You are going to receive the money from a particular debtor, right, on a future date. Say after 2 months, a debtor is going to pay you. So that future receivable of yours, you give it as a security to the bank. That is called as the assignment. Assignment represents a transfer of an existing or a future debt, right, or property belonging to a person in favor of another person. You say after 2 months, this debtor is going to pay me. Yes, so this you give it as a security to the bank. It's only actionable claim. Claim to any debt other than debt secured by mortgage of movable property or the hypothecation or pledge, such as book debts and a life insurance policy. Okay, after 2 months, this life insurance policy of mine is going to mature. When I receive the money, it will be yours in case if I don't repay the loan. Right, so you've given it as a security to the bank. Your existing or future debt are accepted by banks as way of security by way of the assignment. Right, so that is assignment. Then I have an account with that bank, my savings account with the bank, and from the same account I have taken a loan also. So in case if I don't repay the loan, can the bank adjust the balance in my deposit account against the loan account? Yes, so that is the setup. Right, so I've taken a loan from the bank, same bank I've kept a deposit also. Right, so in case if I don't repay the loan, can the bank adjust it against my deposit account? Yes. Right, so set off is the statutory right of the creditor to adjust wholly or partly the debit balance in the debtor's account against any credit balance lying in another account of the debtor. Right, the right of set off enables the bank to combine two accounts, a deposit account and a loan account of the same person, provided both the accounts are in the same name, same right, that is in the same capacity. Right, so both accounts are in the name of the individual, and all the branches of the bank are treated as one entity. You know, so you've taken loan from one branch of the bank, but you've kept deposit with another branch of the bank. Can it be set off? Yes. It can be set off, right? So that is the set off. And then you have the lien, right? What is lien? A legal right to seize and dispose and liquidate the assets under the lien, right? So bank can take possession of any of your asset, excess, liquidate that asset and recover the money, right? So where bank has the power to liquidate your assets, that is the lien, right? So mode of creation of the security: mortgage, pledge, hypothecation, assignment, set off, and the lien. right? Mode of creation of the security, right? And now we talk about the RBI prudential norms, right? Now we are going to talk about the RBI prudential norm. And in that, the first thing which we are going to discuss is that when does an asset of a bank become a non-performing asset, right? When does an asset of a bank become a non-performing asset? Okay, so one, it says any credit facility which the borrower has availed from the bank, if it is overdue for more than 90 days, right? Overdue for more than 90 days, then it says it becomes an NPA. Right, then for CC overdraft, for cash credit overdraft, when does that become an NPA? It says when it gets the out of order status. When does it get the out of order status? One, it says if it has exceeded the sanctioned limit. If it has exceeded the sanctioned limit, or what does it say? Right, there are no credits continuously for 90 days. And only you are overdrawing, but have you deposited any money? No. Right? So no credits continuously for the 90 days. Or there are credits, you know, or there are credits, but the credits are not enough even to cover the interest debited during the period, right? So credits are not enough to cover even the interest debited during the period, right? So interest charge us period mein aaya, that was 10,000, and what you have credited in the account is only 7,000. So even that much also you've not credited, that is enough to cover the interest debited during the period. Again, it says you become a CC overdraft, right? Out of order state. Right, it gets the out of order status. And third one is for the agricultural advances. What does it say? Agricultural advances, when do they become an NPA? One, you have to see that whether the agricultural advance has it been given for the short duration crops or has it been given for the long duration crops. And the short duration crops like the pulses and so, or the long duration crops like say tea, coffee, rubber or so. And so it says for the short duration crop, if it is overdue for more than two crop seasons, right? Overdue for more than two crop seasons. And for the long duration crops, if it is overdue for more than one crop season, then it says it becomes an NPA. Right, so agricultural advances, it depends upon the crop season. CC overdraft, it says when it gets the out of order status. And apart from that, any other credit facility if it is overdue for more than 90 days. Right, if it is overdue for more than 90 days. Right, so one, an asset of a bank could be a standard asset or it could be the non-performing asset. Right, and I just told you okay, when does an asset of a bank become a non-performing asset? Right, under standard, it could be standard regular. And it is like absolutely every month the customer is paying the installment on time. Right, or under the standard, it could be the SMA. What is SMA? It could be the special mention account. Right, it could be the special mention account. In special mention account, you have SMA 0, SMA 1 and the SMA 2. SMA 0, wherein the account is showing some stress signals. You come to know that, oh, borrower condition not good or so. Or if you say it is overdue for 31 to 60 days or overdue for 61 to 90 days. That means it is not an NPA so far, but looks like coming soon. And because what do we say? Overdue for more than 90 days, then it becomes NPA. Say right now it is overdue for more than 80 days. So abhi to nahi hai NPA. But kya lagta hai ki very soon. And okay, this account will become an NPA. Right? So that is standard regular and standard special mention account. In that you have SMA 0, SMA 1 and SMA 2. And non-performing asset, the moment the asset of a bank becomes a non-performing asset, it comes and sits into the substandard category. And also substandard asset, right? NPA up to 12 months, it comes and sits into the substandard category. Right? Then if it continues to remain in NPA category for more than 12 months, right? So now it says it becomes the doubtful asset. And then it says loss has to be identified. So see, there is a provision for going from standard to substandard, substandard to doubtful, but there is no time limit for going from doubtful to loss. It says loss has to be identified by the bank, the RBI, the internal inspection team, or the auditors, right? The internal, external auditors, or it is of small or uncollectible value. Right, or if it is of the small or the uncollectible value. Right, so that is where we first talk about the classification of the assets of the bank. Right, what does it say? Standard asset or the non-performing asset. And a non-performing asset, it could be the substandard, doubtful, or the loss asset. Right, so NPA up to 12 months, substandard, more than 12 months, doubtful. And then what does it say? Loss has to be identified. Then it is to be treated as a loss asset. Right, so standard loan, standard regular special mention account, and then NPA, in which you have substandard, doubtful, and loss. Right, in the doubtful also we have D1, D2, and D3. Right, so up to 1 year, 1 to 3 year, and more than 3 year. You know, it is sitting into the doubtful category, right? So accordingly, D1, D2, and the D3. And when does an asset of the bank become a non-performing asset? One, we said any credit facility overdue for more than 90 days. CC overdraft, when it gets the out of order status. And then I also taught you regarding the agricultural advances. Right? Out of order, what does it say? When it has exceeded the sanction limit, or there are no credits continuously for 90 days, or credits are there, but not enough even to cover the interest debited during the period. Right, even the interest debited during the period. Right, so again, is there a special question asked in your exams on this one? Out of order, yes. Right, lot of questions seen in your exams regarding the out of order. Right, so when do you say it is overdue? When it is not paid on the due date which has been fixed by the bank. Right, then what is the provisioning percentages for these non-performing assets over here? It says for these substandard assets, you have a general provision of 15%. Right, for doubtful, up to 1 year, 1 to 3 year, more than 3 year. And then it says secured, unsecured. For unsecured, 100% provision. And for secured, 25, 40, and the 100. And for loss asset, again, what is required is the 100% provision. Right, so now if I talk about the provisioning of the NPA, the non-performing assets, right? So you have the substandard asset for which there is a general provision of 15%, right? Then for the doubtful asset, you have to check whether it is doubtful up to 1 year, 1 to 3 year, or more than 3 year. And then whether it is secured or unsecured. If it is unsecured, anyways, it is going to be always 100%. And for the secured, first year 25, then 40, then 100%. Right? And then for the loss asset, how much provision is required? 100% provision is required for the loss asset. Right? So this is again important from the viewpoint of the MCQ. Right, the provisioning percentages. Right, then say the borrower has amazing financial condition, amazing business is going on, but he is not repaying the loan of the bank. He's given for a 1 crore loan, he's given you 10 crore security. So then you will say, oh, this borrower, if he doesn't pay, also okay, because he's given 10 crore security. It says no. And a classification of NPA is based on record of recovery. Availability of security, net worth of the borrower, guarantor is not to be taken into account for the purpose of treating an asset as an NPA. Okay, then say a particular borrower, say Mr. A, has taken 3 loans from the bank. Right, one, he has taken a vehicle loan. Right, second, he has taken a personal loan. And third, say he has taken a CC overdraft from the bank. Out of that, say one becomes an NPA, say the vehicle loans become an NPA. Other two, there is no NPA, but still will the other two be also considered to be NPA? Yes, because what does it say? Asset classification is borrower wise and not facility wise. Any one facility given to a borrower becomes an NPA. All the facilities given to the same borrower becomes an NPA. You cannot say, ori, the other two loan to is repaying on time. No. Any one of them is not paying on time, all of them are to be treated as an NPA, and a prudence, conservative. So asset classification is to be done borrower wise and not a facility wise. Okay, right. Then after that, another point over there. Accounts regularized near about the balance sheet date. That this borrower, what did you see? Now, 1st April 2029, and now year end is 31st March 2030. Right? So June, July, August, September, October, November, December, January, February. Never, never, never ever paid the loan installment on time. Never paid it or paid it late or something like that. All of a sudden, month of March, you see a change in the, what you say, behavior. All of a sudden came to bank and deposited the loan installment. Right? So now you see, okay, oh, is this just becoming good for 31st March and again 1st April, same old story. Right? So that is why you have to be more careful for accounts which are regularized near about the balance sheet date. In a solitary, small few credits are recorded just before the balance sheet date. And you say, full year you don't go to the temple. All of a sudden, 16 Jan, you go to temple. Even God is wondering, what happened today? How come this person has come to temple? Then they say, today see a result. That is why I have come to temple. And that is why today have come. God says, go back. Did not study all the days. Now today coming to temple, what will happen? Go home. Take library admission. Okay, right. So what does it say? Few credits. And then you say, ye kuch nahi hai. Ye jaise the waise hi rahenge. Inherent weakness on the basis of data available. The account should be deemed to be an NPA. Right? And for this auditor, you need to check the transactions immediately before the close of the year and immediately after the close of the year. And a cutoff to get a knowledge of the objective behind the transaction. Right? So maybe they are just preventing the borrower from slipping into the NPA category, because the moment you come into NPA, you have to make 15% provision, substandard. You make that much provision, that much your income profit is shown less. Right? So maybe just to prevent, it from slipping into the NPA category, bank would have said, "Arey arey, kar do re, thoda deposit kar do." And so accounts regularized near about the balance sheet date. Okay, then say Mr. B has taken a loan from the bank, right? But who has given, if Mr. B has taken a loan from the bank, and who has given the guarantee for this loan? Central government. And now say the loan is overdue for more than 90 days. What does it say? Is it to be treated as an NPA? No. Provided the guarantee is not cancelled when presented. It is not repudiated when invoked. Provided the central government guarantee has not been cancelled when invoked. Right? And this applies only to the central government guaranteed advances and not to the state government guaranteed advances. State government guarantee advance overdue for more than 90 days, chalo, you become an NPA. Right? But central government guaranteed advances, it says, even though if overdue for more than 90 days, need not be treated as an NPA. But this will apply only to the asset classification. Will it apply to the income recognition? No, it will not apply to the income recognition. For income recognition purpose, it is to be considered as an NPA. Only for asset classification purpose, it will not be considered to be an NPA. Right, so central government guaranteed advances where guarantee is not invoked or repudiated, cancelled, would be classified as standard asset but will be regarded as NPA for income recognition. And however, this will not apply to the state government guaranteed advances. There it would be considered to be an NPA. Right, then consortium, that more than one bank is coming together and giving the loan. Right? And now say two banks are coming together and giving the loan to a borrower, and a bank A and bank B. Right, but borrower says, I don't want to deal with two banks. I will deal with one bank, and that one bank will settle the account with the other bank. Right, so borrower has given the loan ka, what you say, installment, but bank A has not given the share to bank B. Right, then bank B, should you treat it as an NPA? Yes, because you have not received the share from the lead bank, and then you are the co-bank. Or say there are two banks and they say both are co-bank, and a borrower says, no problem, I will pay separately to both the bank. But now borrower is having lack of funds. That is why he is only paying the installment to bank A and not paying the installment to bank B. Right? So bank A, do you need to classify the account as an NPA? No, for you it is a standard asset. But bank B, do you need to classify the asset as an NPA? Yes. है ना, इंडिविजुअल रिकॉर्ड ऑफ रिकवरी. यू से नहीं, उनको मिला है तो हमने क्यों एनपीए करना चाहिए? अरे उनको मिला है, तुम्हें थोड़ी मिला है. यू कंटिन्यू टू क्लासिफाई द अकाउंट एज एन एनपीए. Right, so consortium advances. What does it say? If the lead bank does not give the share to the co-bank, it says treat it as an NPA. And obviously, NPA classification is based on the individual record of recovery. Right, so one co-bank is getting the installment, other bank is not getting the installment. Other bank, you treat it as an NPA. And other bank, you need to treat it as an NPA. Okay, right, then consortium cash credit. If more than one bank is coming together and giving the cash credit, it says again the lead bank will be responsible for computing the drawing power. Right, the lead bank will be responsible for computing the drawing power. Right, then accounts where there is an erosion in the value of security or fraud committed by borrower. That means what? Right, say the value of the security against which the advance was given, say it was 100 rupees. Now say the value of that security has become 40%. That means what? The erosion in the value of the security, is it more than 50%? More than 50% erosion in the value of security? Yes. So it says straight away. Hai na, seedha utha ke, hai na, usko patko, where you are going to put away it, straight away classified as the doubtful asset. And say 100 rupees ka security ka value has now become 3 rupees. That is straight, that is more than 90% erosion in value of security. It says straight away you classify it as the loss asset. Seedha. And straight away it is to be classified as the loss asset. Right? So more than 50% erosion, straight away doubtful. More than 90% erosion, straight away loss asset. Right, so accounts where there is an erosion, straight away doubtful, straight away loss asset. Okay, right, then advance given against these five best friends. Who are the five best friends? Term deposits, NSC, National Savings Certificate, Kisan Vikas Patra, Indira Vikas Patra, life policy. What does it say? Need not be treated as an NPA. Like how your central government guaranteed advances. What did we say? No need to treat them as an NPA. Right, similarly over here, it says if the loan has been given against the security of FD or the term is or the NSC or the IVP, KVP or the life policy, need not be treated as an NPA. And then sometimes the natural calamities, they affect the repayment capacity of the agricultural borrower. And some flood or fire, you know, drought or something, right? That is why the borrower, what you say, the agricultural borrowers are not able to repay the bank loan. So that is why bank gives them some own relief measures. That is conversion of the short-term loan into term loan or reschedulement or sanctioning of a fresh loan. Right? So then it says that these, what you say, the asset classification income recognition norms will apply to the rescheduled terms. Okay, forget whatever was the old schedule because now bank has given them their relief measure. So forget this and now you apply the prudential norms to the rescheduled terms. Right, now the NPA provisioning classification norms are to be applied to the rescheduled terms. Right, then advances to staff. What does it say? Okay, generally when bank is giving an advance to their own staff, like say I'm working in State Bank of India and I may require a loan. Right, so it says for their own employees, bank has a policy that first you repay the principal and then you pay the interest. And first you repay the principal and then you pay the interest. So at the time when I'm repaying the principal, the interest need not be considered as overdue. Why? Because interest is going to be due only after the payment of the principal. That is the policy the bank has for their staff. Generally for a loan, when repayment is to be done, both principal and interest is to be repaid. We call it as EMI. But for their staff, bank may have a policy that first you repay your principal, then you pay the interest. Right, so when the principal is being repaid, will the interest be considered to be overdue? No, it is not due only. So there is no question of it becoming overdue. And these advances which a bank has given to its staff, will it show it under BCT, SCU? No, it will come under the others. Again, this has been asked as an MCQ. Right, this has been asked as an MCQ. Right, under the schedule of the other assets. Right, then agricultural advances, I told you long duration crops overdue for more than one crop season and short duration crops overdue for more than two crop season, right? So for short duration crops, two crop season, for long duration crop, if it is overdue for more than one crop season, right? Then they talk about the computation of the drawing power. And the drawing power is regarding how much CC overdraft limit you can get from the bank. There's something called as drawing power and something called as the sanctioned limit. Sanction limit is the total exposure that the bank is ready to give for except for a particular client. And obviously, a particular account has to be kept within both. It has to be kept within the drawing power also as well as within the sanctioned limit. Right? So what is drawing power? It is the cash credit limit. And what is sanctioned limit? It is the total limit. Right? It is the total exposure that the bank is ready to accept for a particular client. And an account has to be kept within both drawing power also and the sanction limit also. Right? So obviously, what is the bank's duty? To check the adequacy of the current assets. Right? So current assets, the stock statements have to be submitted to the bank. And stock statement older than 3 months, then it says it will be deemed as irregular. तो एक आध महीना स्टॉक स्टेटमेंट नहीं सबमिट किया, 2 महीने नहीं किया, ठीक है, 3 महीने से ज्यादा, इट सेज नाउ इट विल बी डीम्ड एज इररेगुलर. व्हाट इज ऑडिटर्स ड्यूटी? टू चेक द स्टॉक स्टेटमेंट्स एंड ऑल सबमिटेड बाय द बोरोवर. देन ऑल्सो चेक द कंप्यूटेशन ऑफ डीपी हैज बीन डन एज पर द बोर्ड ऑफ डायरेक्टर्स गाइडलाइन MCQ. Okay, who will lay down the guidelines for computation of the DP? The board of directors, right? And proper reporting has been done of the sundry creditors, that is all the payables of the borrower. And sometimes the bank may also require a stock audit if the exposure is more than 5 crore. Sometimes if it's less than 5 crore, even in that case, the stock audit may be required, right? Sometimes even in that case, the stock audit may be required, okay? Right, so what we'll do, we'll come to this audit of advances, but we'll just see one question regarding this computation of DP, and the computation of the drawing power. Okay, right, so over here, yeah, this one. Compute the drawing power for cash credit limit for the month of March 22 for the following information. Stock 50,000, debtor 45,000, debtors of 5,000 for an invoice 17 November 2021. Right, sundry creditors 15,000, sanction limit. And an account has to be kept within both the cash, what you say, the drawing power also and the sanction limit. Margin on stock is 20% and on debtors is 50%. And debtors older than 3 months are ineligible for calculation of DP. And so this is 17 November 2021. So it's older than 3 months. Right? So stock 50,000. How much margin is to be kept on the stock? 20%. So 50,000 minus 20%. That will give you the as what you say, stock minus the is unpaid stock, that is sundry creditors. And then how much is the margin for the stock you need to keep is the 20%, right? So what is the value of the stock over there? 28,000. And for the computation of DP power, right? So stock minus the creditors, how much are the creditors they have? 15,000. So how much are the paid stock? 35,000. In that you put a 20% margin. So what is the value of stock for drawing power? 28,000, right? Then debtors 45,000, debtors older than 3 months 5,000, ineligible, eligible debtors 40,000. Then margin is 50%. So what is the value of the debtor? 20,000. And what is the drawing power? 48,000. But what is the sanctioned limit? 45,000. So that is why what is going to be the drawing power also? 45,000. Right? That is why what is going to be the drawing power also? 45,000. Right? So that is one area where they are asking the question. Right? Then Puranjay is appointed as an auditor of 2 branches of a nationalized bank, and while verifying the advances of one semi-urban branch, he noticed substantial number of accounts categorized as SMA. Right? Explain the nature and significance of SMA and a special mention account, right, which can help in preventing turning potential NPAs into actual NPA. Then, while verifying interest income of a mid-corporate branch of an urban sector having advances consisting only cash credit limit for large borrower, it was noticed that advances of 300 crore were outstanding, carrying average rate of interest of 8%. One article team make quick back of the envelope calculations of interest income as 24 crore. Okay, 300 ka 8%, 24 crore. However, the schedule of P&L shows interest income only of 10 crore. Discuss any two problems probable reason for such variation. One, cash credit account being varies in nature, a running account, and the utilization depends on the needs of business. Interest on cash credit account is charged on the extent of the funds utilized by the borrower. It could be possible that all cash credit limits were not fully utilized, and some large accounts may have been sanctioned during the later part of the year, resulting in lower interest income on the advances. Right? So that is a very different type of question over there. Right? Then financial statements of a bank are prepared in a specified format, right? So they are prepared as per the Banking Regulation Act, right? The balance sheet and the profit and loss, the Form A and the Form B. Right. Ranjana Ceramic Private Limited has sanctioned a cash credit limit of the 100 lakh from a branch of LMO Bank. Besides, branch has also sanctioned a one-time bank guarantee of 10 lakh on behalf of the company in favor of a statutory authority. Right. What type of credit facility has been granted? So cash credit is a funded credit facility, whereas bank guarantee is a non-funded credit facility. Right. During the course of audit of a branch of a nationalized bank, you find that the system has generated a report making 10 term loan accounts as SMA. Let's discuss meaning of SMA account and significance of such classification. Right. So which is 0 to 90 days. Since period of 90 days has not been exceeded as on that date, such accounts have not been classified as NPA. Such a classification is significant as early recognition of such account enables banks to take initiate remedial action to prevent potential slippages of such accounts into NPA. That is why they are called as the special mention account. Right, then one more question again regarding the computation of the drawing power. Right, then you want to verify the interest on deposits paid by the branch. Discuss any two analytical procedure, right? So we have to talk about the interest expense of the bank, right? We have to talk about the audit of the interest expense of the bank. Okay, right. And then here there is a question regarding out of order. N Limited has been sanctioned cash credit limit by XYZ of 1 crore and drawing power is 80 lakh. Outstanding balance in the account is 75 lakh. Interest charge to the account is 3.5 lakh and total credit into the account is 2.5. Right. So even the credits in the period are not enough even to cover the interest debited during the period. That is why the account will be treated as out of order. And okay, credit is of 2.5. Interest debited during the period is of 3.5. Right. Then what does it say? Again, check out of order status. And then again, the loan given against the different securities. Okay. Right. So anyways, we've completed our theory part of the discussion regarding the advances of the bank. Now we are going to talk about the audit of the advances of the bank. Now we are going to talk about the audit of the advances of the bank, right? So one, for the audit of the advances of the bank, what does it say? One, auditor, you need to check the internal control. Right, over the advances. Then what are the audit procedures? Right, so audit procedures for the audit of the advances. And then third question over there is regarding the recoverability of the advances. Right, third question which you see over there is the recoverability. Okay, as an auditor, what sufficient appropriate evidence would you like to obtain regarding the recoverability of the advances? Okay, so first one, internal control over the advances of the bank. Right, so will the bank be, you know, like calling everybody and saying, yeah, come, you want loan, come. Oh, you go to bank and say, I want loan of 10 crore. Bank says, come, take loan of 10 crore. No, like that to any Tom, Dick and Harry, the bank doesn't get up and give a loan. Otherwise, they will all become a shower of NPA on the bank. And so that is why what internal control is required in the bank over the advances. First internal control is that bank, you need to do the assessment of the credit worthiness of the borrower. And a credit worthiness, there should be a system in the bank to do the assessment of the credit worthiness of the borrower. The moment you go to the bank and you say, bank, we want a loan, bank will say, go and get all these documents and income tax return and salary slip and all your property documents and all of that. So bank will ask for a lot of documents. And then also bank will ask for the security. Then that security, the bank will also check whether it is approved the security and also register it in the name of bank if it is required to be registered. then based on all of this, then the loan will be sanctioned. And again, it should be sanctioned within the limit. If it has exceeded the limit, then again, an objection should be raised. Right? So this is all at the time when the loan has been given. And then after the loan has been given, they will check whether the repayment of the loan is done on time, whether the market value of the security is proper, or is there any erosion in the value of security. Right? So that is where we talk about the evaluation of the internal control. So number one internal control in the bank, that don't go on distributing the loan as if you're distributing sweets. Right? So it says first the bank should give an advance to a customer only after satisfying itself as to the credit worthiness of the borrower. Then all the necessary documents should be executed. Then compliance with the terms of sanction and the end use of funds should be ensured. Then there should be the sufficient margin as specified in the sanction letter should be kept against the security. So if I give a security of 20 crore, against that entire security, bank is not going to give me a loan. They are going to keep a margin. And then ownership of these securities, whether it is to be transferred in the name of the bank. Then registration of the security, whether they are to be registered in the name of the bank. Then in case if the loan has been given against the good, again, the contents of the packages, the inspection of the godown is required to be done. Right? Then drawing power register has to be updated every month. Then account has to be kept both within drawing power and the sanction limit. If any limits have been exceeded, it says it should be brought to the notice of the controlling authority regularly, and the review of the account should be done at least once in a year and at more frequent intervals in case of the large advances. And so this is at the time when the loan is being sanctioned by the bank. The bank needs to be very vigilant. It first has to do the proper assessment of the credit worthiness of the borrower, right? The loan documents, the security, the margin, the register, the goods, right? Then whether it's within the limit, is that exceeded the limit, and the review of the operation. Right. Then after that, we talk about the audit procedures for the audit of the advances. So my dear students, very important point of concern. Okay, exam mein you have to be able to identify the question. Okay, are they asking me the internal controls over the advances, or are they telling me ke please tell us the audit procedures for doing the audit of the advances? Right, so audit procedures, that means in the balance sheet of the bank, you see advances, 31st March 2030, 10,000 crore. Example, right, like how we saw in State Bank of India also the amount over there. Right, so now I have to do the audit of these advances, right, as that 31st March 2030. Right, so first this 10,000 crore, it should be the amount which is due to the bank. It should be the amount which is outstanding as on the date of balance sheet, and there should be no unrecorded advances. Right? So obviously this amount of 10,000 crore, it should show the amount which is due to the bank. It should be outstanding and there should be no unrecorded advances. Then all these advances, they have to be supported by the adequate loan documents. Then after that, they should be properly classified, described and disclosed in accordance with the accounting principles and policies. Then also how the valuation of these advances has been done based on the recoverability of advances, and accordingly whether the appropriate provision has been done. Right, so what does it say? It's due to the bank, outstanding on the date of balance sheet, no unrecorded advances. Then after that, again, the loan documents, then properly classified, described and disclosed. Then also the basis for the valuation and the appropriate provision has been done towards the advances. Right, the appropriate provision. And then it talks about some substantive audit procedures and detailed checking. So what does it say? Auditor, in detail, you check all the large accounts and other accounts you checked on a sample basis. So what does it say? Examine all the large accounts, and other than large accounts, it says you check them on a sample basis. When do you say that it's a large advance? It says if the year-end balance is in excess of 2 crore or it is 5% of the aggregate year-end advances of the branch, whichever is the less. Right, so 2 crore or in higher than 5% of the aggregate year-end advances of the branch, whichever is less. Right, so large advances, small advances. Then apart from large advances, it says auditor, you also check for the problem accounts. right? Where the amount may be insignificant, but again, if you see that this is the troublemaking account, right? And also check those accounts which have been adversely commented upon by whom? By the RBI, by the concurrent auditor. Bank's internal inspection should also be included in the auditor's review. Right, so what all type of advances you're going to check? Large advances, small advances, problem advances, and the adversely commented upon advances. Right, adversely commented upon advances. And then after that, it says, auditor, you need to obtain the SAAE. Right? So substantive procedures for the four types of advances. Right, and then it talks about the areas to be examined for obtaining the evidence. Right, so one, it says you check the amount, then check the documentation, then check the operation of the account, okay, whether installments are received on time. Then you check the value of the security, then RBI prudential norm for classification, provisioning, have they been followed, and carry out the appropriate analytical procedure. Right, carry out the appropriate analytical procedure. Right, so that is for the audit of the advances. I hope you've had a wonderful time, right, listening to the discussion regarding the advances, everyone. Okay, and now we talk about the income of the bank and the expense of the bank. So one, we have to discuss what is included in the income of the bank, and then how to do the audit, and then what is included in the expense of the bank and how to do the audit of the expense of the bank. Right, so what is included in the income of the bank, right? So again, if I come over here, right, to the State Bank of India, right? So these are their fixed deposits, other assets, contingent liability. Yes, then they have their income, interest income, other income, then interest expended, operating expenses, and the provisions and contingency, right? So interest earned and the other income. So interest earned. In interest earned, they have interest discount on advances and bill. And so whatever loans have been given by the bank and whatever bills sent to the bank for collection or discounted or so. Then income on investment, interest on balance with RBI and other interbank funds, and then the others. Right, so interest discount, income on investment, interest on balances with the RBI and the other interbank funds, and then the others. Right, and then you have the, this is the main income of the bank, interest earned, and then you have the other income. Right, commission, exchange, brokerage, then profit or loss on sale of investment, revaluation, sale of land, building, exchange transaction, dividend, credit card fee, insurance premium income, right, recoveries made in write-off accounts, and the miscellaneous income. Right, so that is the interest earned and the other income. Right, so over here now, what do they talk about? Okay, what is the income of the bank? Interest earned and the other income. Right, under the interest earned, what do they have? Interest discount on advance bill, then interest income on the investment, then interest on balance with RBI, other interbank funds, and others, which is not included in the above heads. Right, do they ask an MCQ on this one? Yes. Right. And then what comes in the other income of the bank? What comes in the other income of the bank? Commission, exchange, brokerage. Commission, exchange, brokerage, it says commission on bills for collection, commission exchange on the remittances, transfers, and a demand draft, NEFT, commission on letters of credit, loan processing charges, mobile banking fee, credit debit card fee, rent from lending or letting out of the locker, commission on government business, commission on other permitted secured agency business, brokerage on security, fee on insurance referral, mutual fund client, banking charges like custodian, DMAT, investment advisory. Right, then profit on sale of investment, revaluation of fixed asset, income earned by way of dividend from subsidiary joint venture, and the miscellaneous income. Right, so they ask, you know, mobile banking fee, is it to be included in the main income of the bank? Right, mobile banking fee, MCQ now. Okay, mobile banking fee, does it come in the main income of the bank? No, main income is interest earned. And so interest discount on advance bill, then interest income on investment, then interest on advances with RBI and other interbank funds, and others not included under the above heads. Right? So that is interest income and the interest earned and then the other income. Right. Then now coming to the audit procedures, right? So in the audit procedures, what do they say? That one, auditor, you need to check whether the income of the bank, interest income, interest earned, other income, all income of the bank, has it been properly recorded, Right? So you need to check whether the transaction really took place. Is it related to the bank? There is no unrecorded income and it is recorded at the appropriate amount. Right? So as an auditor, you want to obtain reasonable assurance that income of the bank has been properly recorded. Right? OCACC, occurrence, completeness, accuracy, cutoff, and classification. That has the income of the bank been properly recorded? For that, auditor wants the reasonable assurance. Then, if the income is exceeding 1% of the total income of the bank, then it should be recognized on accrual basis. If it is not exceeding 1% of the total income of the bank, then it says it should be recognized on the cash basis. Right? So, if it is exceeding 1%, then accrual basis. If it is not exceeding 1% of the total income of the bank, it may be recognized when received. Then it says if there is a Yes, what you say, no uncertainty about the ultimate collection of the income, then it can be recognized on the accrual basis, right? So if there is no uncertainty about the ultimate collection, no doubt regarding the ultimate collection of the income, then it says it should be recognized on the accrual basis. But if there is any doubt, uncertainty regarding the ultimate collection, then it says the income should be recognized on the cash basis. Right? So if there is an uncertainty about the ultimate collection, like in case of the non-performing asset, then such income should be recognized only when it is actually collected. Right? So if there is a doubt regarding the ultimate collection, then it should be recognized on the cash basis. Right, so did you get the first 5 points? One, reasonable assurance that income of the bank is properly recorded. Then if it exceeds 1% of total income, accrual basis. If it does not exceed that, if it is not material as per the above norm, then cash basis. If there is no doubt regarding the ultimate collection, accrual basis. If there is a significant uncertainty regarding ultimate collection, then it should be recognized on the cash basis. Then after that, the advances against securities, those five best friends, and a term deposits, NSE, IVP, KVP, life policy. What does it say? They can be taken into income account on the due date. Right? So that means again, the income can be recorded on the accrual basis, provided adequate margin is available in the account. Right? So in no need to treat it as an NPA, no need to recognize the income on the cash basis. You can continue to recognize the income on the accrual basis for these five best friends, provided there is adequate margin. Right? Then bill purchase, right? Say bill purchased in 2000, what do you say, October 2029, but it is to be received, you know, the money is going to be received in, say, April 2030. Something like that, right? So now some part of the income, October, November, December, January, February, March, 6 months income will come in the 1 year and 1 month income will go in the next year, right? So bills purchased and discounted, the income should be apportioned between the 2 years. Then bills sent to the bank for collection, the income should be recognized when the bill is actually collected and not when the bill is received by the bank, but when the bill is actually collected. Then any renegotiation, right? So any loan given and now not able to repay. So now it says new schedule has been given. Right? So renegotiation. Again, it says for renegotiation, the income is to be recognized on the accrual basis. Right, so that is audit of the income of the bank. What does it say? One, you have to obtain the reasonable assurance. Then what does it say? If it exceeds 1% of total income, then accrual basis. If it does not exceed 1% of the total income, then when it is actually realized, then there is no uncertainty regarding the ultimate collection. No uncertainty, then it is to be recognized on the accrual basis. If there is an uncertainty, significant uncertainty regarding the ultimate collection, then it is to be recognized on the cash basis. Right? Then bills purchased, what does it say? It has to be apportioned between the 2 years, and it has to be apportioned. Then bills collected, it says when actually when the bills are collected, you know, for the bills collected. Then the five best friends, term deposits, NSE, IVP, KVP, it says the income can be recognized on the accrual basis on the due date, provided there is adequate margin which is available in the accounts, right? Provided there is adequate margin and renegotiation of the loans have been done and any fees commission on the renegotiation. Again, what does it say? It is to be recognized on the accrual basis, right? It is to be recognized on the accrual basis. Are you understanding this point? It is to be recognized on the accrual basis. Okay. Now, what did we say? Okay, when does an asset of a bank become a non-performing asset? What did we say? When it is overdue for more than 90 days. Right. So, up to 90 days, it sits into the standard SMA account. Right. And then more than 90 days, it comes and sits into the NPA category. And so till the time it did not become an NPA, you would have continued to recognize the income on the accrual basis, you know, because it was your standard asset, you know, special mention account, but standard only. So you continue to recognize the income on the accrual basis. But the date on which your asset becomes an NPA, that is the D date. You know, that is the important date. So what you do on that date, all income already accrued. Okay, aaj tak ka jo bhi income ye asset pe accrue kiya tha, jo ab NPA ban gaya hai, all income already accrued, you reverse. All further accrual of income, you stop. And all income recognition on an NPA is to be done on the actual basis. It is to be done on the realization basis. It is to be done on the cash basis. Why? Concept of prudence. Your asset is becoming NPA. Where you are accruing income on such non-performing asset? So, jo bhi income abhi tak accrue kiya tha, reverse. Further accrual of income, stop. And all income recognition on an NPA is to be done on the cash basis, realization basis, actual basis. Right, so reversal of income, all income already accrued. The moment an asset becomes an NPA, what you do? All income already accrued, you reverse. Further accrual of income, you stop. And all income recognition on an NPA is to be done on the cash basis. So let it be your leased assets or takeout finance. Now that's an another term over there. You know, you are taking a loan and then there are stages of the loan. First, you are taking a loan from the bank for purchase of land. Then after purchase of land, you are taking a loan from the bank for setting up of the manufacturing plant. Then after the manufacturing plant, you are taking a loan from the bank for purchase of inventory, raw material. Right. So obviously when one stage is over, then you get the loan for the next stage. Right. So that is called as the takeout finance, right? Mainly for the property development. Right. So to expand the sources, then at least address the sectoral group entity exposure issues and also long-term debt for the finance of the project. Right. So you can read this point over there regarding the takeout finance. Right. Then what if a borrower repays the loan? Will you adjust it against principal or will you adjust it against interest first? It says it depends on the policy of the bank. You know, okay, borrower had to repay 10 lakh loan and 2 lakh interest. And out of that, now borrower has paid 5 lakh. So should you adjust it entirely against the interest or principal or proportionately between two? It says it depends on the policy of the bank. And so it is to be decided by the bank and then the policy has to be followed in a uniform, consistent manner. And income on NPA is not to be recognized. But had it not been an NPA, how much income we would have earned on this that you can keep on making a memorandum of the same. And so you don't include this while calculating your grosses, what this interest income in the memorandum account, but just... you know, had it not been an NPA, how much income we would have earned? Can you maintain a memorandum account for that? Yes. And interest income on investment, it says it is based on the, right, what you say, the date on which the investments income has been earned. Profit on sale of investment, again, it is to be taken to profit and loss account. And profit on revaluation, again, to be taken to the profit and loss account. Right, so that is our discussion regarding the income of the bank and also how to do the audit of the income of the bank. And now we are just left with one part of the discussion over there, which is regarding the expenses of the bank. What are the different expenses of the bank? And then after that, how you do the audit of the expenses of the bank. And that will be a completion of the chapter number 10, which is regarding the bank audit. And then I come to the most important terms for our discussion regarding audit risk, audit procedure, audit evidence and so. Right, so let's take a break. After the break, we'll complete with this expense part. And then after that, start with our discussion for chapter number 3 and 4. Okay.